given that I'm about to interview John Cameron Mitchell, I feel a little at odds that I did not see the live show Hedwig. But I was like, you know, what could this be about? It didn't look like my thing, you know?
I knew it was off-Broadway, I knew it was in the West Village, but I don't really think I knew what an amazing event it was. It was ahead of its time in the sense that it dealt with the idea of trans, it dealt with sexual issues, it dealt with rock music, it dealt with a renegade spirit.
And he somehow rethought what drag could be in a way. When he does Hedwig, you know, drag becomes empowering.
And now that Hedwig is being revived on Broadway, he's now doing this show in a culture where the trans umbrella is struggling for a cultural identity, and it is a phenomenon.
It's just, I just don't know how much to get hung up on, you know, the nuts and bolts of the show. We gotta try to make it, it's gotta be a conversation or else I'm just, I can't overthink it because it's television, and either it's gonna work or it's not. I mean, what the fuck? It's like, you know, what's the real conversation? I know about rock and roll. I know about Lou Reed. You know, I know about, you know, sexuality to a certain degree. I know what's provocative and what isn't. You know, I can find these points of relating to this guy, but I'm still like, you know, aggravated, you know, because I don't know what it's going to feel like to engage with him.
Can I just tell you something? This is not that aggravated. This is usually this aggravated. What the fuck am I going to talk to this guy about for an hour? Why did we do this?
That was when I was interested. I thought I could get something. He's into it?
I think so. Yeah.
No one's gauged that?
He's a very, very sweet person.
Good. He's about to meet a monster. There he is.
Hi.
Hi, I'm Mark.
Hi, Mark. Nice to meet you. How are you?
Thanks for doing this.
Sure.
Are you traveling today?
I brought some mementos. I was
oh, good.
Told to bring some mementos.
Oh, cool.
Yeah.
Good to see you.
You too.
I don't know what's going on in the city. I don't understand it anymore.
Where do you live?
L.A.
Okay.
But I lived here, you know, back in the 90s.
Right. So it's different, right?
Completely different. What are we going to do with the bag? You got it?
Let me see. Throw it in the middle?
Yeah, maybe.
Thanks.
Yeah, like, I don't know who these people are. It feels like it's like a vacation town for rich Europeans. Like a vacation island.
I still feel like a New Yorker, but yeah. I don't always recognize it. And I got a lot of trust fund kids in the building now, you know, who are kind of obnoxious.
Yeah.
It's just a little dormy, you know, a little frat dorm.
Yeah.
Like, could you turn it down? It's 2 a.m.
Come
no.
on.
And they're like,
you're the old guy?
They're like, oh, you were in Girls.
That's what
you
want to
come in for
from?
A drink? I'm like, I got to get up first. And then fuck you.
Yeah,
you know,
right,
and I'm like,
right.
Who do you and call? 311 for fuck you, neighbor?
But you look great.
Well, thank you. I just finished the show, so I
How's
you know,
your
had
foot
to get in.
Or your knee?
It doesn't bend as much as it used to. And I.
Is that what you injured?
Yeah. I ripped my meniscus in the middle of the show and finished the show heroically, but had a leg brace for the rest of my run.
I heard from a friend that it was like strangely more focused and intimate because you were not mobile.
Running around.
Right.
Yeah. I had much more fun.
You did?
Yeah. And I wrote it into the show.
Uh-huh.
You know,
yeah.
She got kneecapped by a guy in a sting mask.
Oh, really?
You know.
You kind of came upon it organically?
Yeah, and I wasn't winded after crossing the stage. This is it.
Wow.
This is totally different.
Why did you do the original Hedwig here?
Because no other theater wanted this. I mean,
look
you
at
know,
this.
It's kind of Turkish-y, isn't it?
Well, yeah, this is the same feeling of the bower, like Moroccan or.
Yeah. We brought in some old movie theater seats, built a theater.
Oh, really?
This is where I would exit. At the end of a show, I kind of almost naked and
yeah.
I go into the light.
Yeah.
But we really didn't have any wings, so I kind of went into the stairwell for a triumphant exit.
And that's a weird moment, though, when you have that moment where people are applauding, and there's just you alone
yeah.
in the stairwell,
yeah.
waiting, and then you go out for your encore. So now, when you sit in this room, I mean, it's so different than when it was when you put Hedwig up for the first time. Has this decor annihilated any potential for emotional nostalgia?
I feel nothing.
Oh.
I feel like that ram up there.
Stuffed and...
Looking out, stunned.
Yeah.
At the changes.
So when you came to New York, what year was it? It was 1980?
85 first, which was, you know, New York was pretty rough then. You know, AIDS had just hit, 85.
That was like right in the middle
I came out and AIDS came out at the same time.
Bad timing.
Life and death.
Yeah. How long did you spend in L.A.?
4 years and...
Oh, really?
Yeah, I wasn't really fitting in and I go to New York and always get better roles.
So you're just doing the actor thing?
Yeah, I started writing, but I was doing a lot of MacGyvers and
really?
TV series stuff, yeah.
Yeah.
And some theater at the Taper and, you know, so I was busy, you know.
But no breakout star roles?
I did a leading role in a film, but it didn't really go anywhere. I shot it here though, played a Polish violinist.
So you got cast, so you got out here,
got
where
out.
You got an agent?
I had an agent, and I got a role as the understudy in Huck Finn, in the musical of Huck Finn on Broadway. That's
okay.
How I got out here. Didn't graduate, ran out.
And you came to New York.
I got out, I always did. You know, I moved every year of my life, so I always...
You didn't get attached.
Deep, no. I was always moving on, which is hard for relationships. But I was perfect for acting.
Yeah.
Gypsy. I got an action movie, Band of the Hand, and played kind of a homicidal punk rocker.
We're gonna plant a garden and fertilize it with the nitrogen, and if there's gophers, we're going to get them with a trap. If that doesn't work, we're going to use the gopher gas, and if that doesn't work, we're going to cement it all in and paint it green.
I'd often get a fancy role and then lose it at the last minute, like I was cast in Star Trek Next Generations, and they found out I was really 28 or something, and they said, no, we want the guy to grow up, so they took it away from me, and I'm so glad it didn't happen. I would have been stuck for 7 to 9 years on a fucking series doing 3 lines a day, if I was lucky. In Breakfast Club, I was kind of cast in a loose way. Then they lost the money and did 16 Candles, so...
You could have been a John Hughes kid?
I could have been Anthony Michael Hall, but then I wouldn't have made Hedwig. I wouldn't have done any of those
Well, you can't shoulda, woulda, coulda, but
yeah.
But was Hedwig...
Hedwig was frustration, because I was
That's
bored.
What I was going to ask you. What was the inception of it?
I wanted to write a theater piece that used the story from Plato's Symposium about us being cut in half by the gods and we're seeking our other halves. That's love, you know, seeking your actual
That's where that comes
other
from.
Half, yeah. And make it a real well-made three-acty, you know, play while using elements of stand-up, punk rock, drag.
But that's interesting though, isn't it? The idea of drag and what drag really meant at that time. Because it seems to me that like you were using drag not as a comedic over-the-top thing, but as something empowering.
Which is an older tradition.
It is.
Which is Shakespeare, which is...
And you were aware of that.
The Greeks. I was thinking about Hedwig in that way. She's the third sex, forced into it, not choosing it. Hedwig was a boy in Eastern Communist Germany, and to get over the wall, the only way to do it was to marry an American GI boyfriend, but he had to get a sex change. Which was botched, leaving the Angry Inch.
Yeah.
Hedwig and the Angry Inch.
Disturbing song.
A year later, the GI has left her and she's stuck in a trailer park in Kansas watching the wall come down.
The Berlin Wall has fallen.
That was the center of it. And rock and roll and theater. Rock and roll, not fake rock and roll, you know, like Rent.
But real,
like
rock,
real rock and roll.
I have to assume that, you know, there's plenty of gay dudes that love to rock.
Yeah.
But it's not the subculture that, you know, you think of.
There was a club called Squeeze Box
at
the same time as I was thinking about this.
Yeah.
And my composer ran the house band, and this was the first queer rock, drag rock punk club. And various drag queens who had only lip-synced to that point suddenly were singing with a house band, Zeppelin songs and Butcher Baby by the Plasmatics. Green Day and Courtney Love would show up, and they were like, I don't have to sing like Diana Ross anymore. I'm punk rock, and I didn't even know it. But it was
like a scene. I always heard about it on the East Side. I'm like, no, I don't got any time. I'm sitting in comedy clubs. You're out there having fun.
Yeah.
Just watching, you know, people talk about their problems in front of brick walls for 20 years.
Well, I brought a little of the stand-up to that place because I had some monologues that I wanted to do. And the drag queens were like, you're not a real drag queen. What are you, you know, are you trying to co-opt our world?
Oh, really?
But I was home.
So you're building out the character of Hedwig towards as a monologist.
Towards a theater piece, yeah.
Not a singer?
No, but the character was a singer.
But you didn't sing early on?
I did Broadway musicals, but not rock and roll. I'd never sung rock and roll.
All right, so you put together this show.
We tried to do it in all the regular Usual Suspect theaters.
And what happened?
Nobody wanted us. Public Theater didn't want us. New York Theater Workshop, nobody wanted us.
For what reason? They couldn't
see. Because we were too weird. We were too drag.
But it wasn't that weird. They'd been through Karen Finley. They'd been through...
I know, but that was considered art. Drag was considered trash, you know? And
so this was seen as a drag show?
They just didn't get it. And the loud music, they're like, well, it's not going to move to Broadway. That's where we make our money, so...
Really? So they had already placed all the judgments. This thing's dead in the water.
Some of them do. At the time, I was kind of pissed off.
What time?
When the show opened off Broadway.
Here?
Yeah, people took a, you know, yeah, it's a kind of that weird thing downtown. You're in drag. Actor friends were like, you know, you're doing career suicide? You're doing drag after doing Broadway mainstream?
Ladies and gentlemen, Brooklyn!
Peter Askin, our director, was a producer, built a theater here. I found the space.
He said, fuck it, we're doing it on our own.
Yes. I mean, he was incredibly important as a dramaturg, director, and producer. He made it from an act into a play.
Right.
And people stayed away in droves.
Really?
Yeah. It took the press to make it hip. They were like, this is the thing to see. And then Danny DeVito and David Bowie and Glenn Close and Lou Reed was here. Susan Sontag was here.
Seeing Hedwig.
Bowie was here.
They all saw Hedwig?
Barry Manilow was here watching me play Hedwig.
In this room?
In this room, that was...
Same night?
Unbelievable. Well, I think Marilyn Manson and Barry Manilow were there one night. Madonna and Elliott Smith. But when Lou Reed came upstairs, walked all the way up and looked at me and said, you were beautiful, that was it. I was like, this is it. This is the top zenith of my life.
That's what he said? He said you were
beautiful? Beautiful. Bowie and he were kind of gay icons, but they were kind of more... straight guys
right.
who liked feminine
right.
guys once in a while, but were really more straight.
Right.
But they meant more to me than any of the gay guys.
So that was like the whole history of all of that, of the mythology that
we're here, and I'm crying because it's like they understand, the people that I came, inspired me, were coming and liking it.
You were beautiful, that's what he said.
Oh my God.
That's sweet, that's a
I once followed him into an optometrist's before
yeah.
that, because I just wanted to be next to, I was trying on women's glasses because that was the only ones. I said, Lou, I was just listening to The Blue Mask, you know?
Yeah.
He's like, that's my best work. And I was like, I know.
You know me, Kansas City. I'm the new Berlin Wall. Try to tear me down. I was born on the other side.
So what exactly, what rank was your father?
He was eventually a major general.
So he was a general?
He was the commander of U.S. forces Berlin in the 80s before the wall came down.
Mr. Gorbachev, tear down this wall.
So that's where the Berlin stuff came from in Hedwig.
But you got along with your dad?
I did. I mean, he mellowed out a lot. He was pretty uptight, but a good guy. And then as he retired, he just became very loving. He had Alzheimer's.
Mm.
And it made him very zen. You know, he was very about now, and you could see.
That's all he had.
Alzheimer's people have, you know, they can see beauty better because
yeah.
there's no then and there's uh-huh. no future. So it's what the Buddhists seek.
I always think about that there must be some relief in forgetting. And there must
be... If you can submit to it, yeah.
Well, I mean, they don't really have a choice, do they?
I feel like I'm practicing.
Yeah.
By seeing him, I was like, gosh, okay, if this is congenital, I wonder if I can learn how he did to...
You mean there's grace to it? I thought it was
He found a grace. There's a struggle when you realize you're losing it, or with my dad.
Yeah.
But most people who saw him and knew about Alzheimer's said they'd never seen such grace, you know, later. And you know, comforting thing was that sense of humor remains to the end.
Really?
It has nothing to do with
memory. So he's passed.
It has nothing to do with memory. He passed 2 years ago and had a sense of humor up to the end. The last things you remember are songs and the faces of people you love. And he passed before he lost the memory of us, which was
Oh, thank God, mercy.
But sense of humor, you know, jokes stay because they're not based on...
Right.
So that was... We would just laugh
or sing. So the last things you remember is like...
His gags.
He would repeat them, I would imagine.
He would laugh. He would know what was funny because you have a short 5 second or 3 second memory. So if you can get from the beginning to the line to the end, you get it, right?
Yeah.
It's when memory gets shorter and disappears is the real tragedy. But he hadn't got to that point.
And so this was a guy that had such, you know, discipline,
power
and stature,
and love power around him, and
but to see, like, to remember him from when you were a kid as this uniformed.
Yeah, but you know, weirdly, we had a better relationship in his last years.
Sure.
Because you forget the bad things.
What were the bad things?
Well, you know, he was very tight in the military, but also I think he told me he didn't love his dad. You know, who was commissioner of Social Security in the 50s. You know, it was a Washington family, and it's hard to recover from that, I think. And he loved us really, really well, but would also kind of was scared of it, didn't know what love was. You know, he didn't grow up with it.
Well, how did he handle the gay thing?
At first it was kind of, well, this is fine. And then it was like, you think you can change. He was quite Catholic. He's like, you know, maybe you can become heterosexually competent, you know, that kind
of
language.
That's got to be the title of something. Heterosexually competent.
And then after a while, he just kind of gave up and accepted it and, you know, talked about his own feelings about having had his own attractions to guys. And,
oh, yeah?
Yeah. And
he said he wrestled with them or that he had them?
Well, you know, he had experienced stuff, and so he understood. And I think the Catholic thing, you know, it had to be nipped in the bud and, you know. But it was like he was really reaching out, and it was not... often that way, you know, and with mom it was much harder, you know, she's super Catholic, and so it was like,
Oh, really?
I'm going to hell, and, you know, she really wanted me to be right with God in her way. And
did your mother see Hedwig?
Yes, and, you know, it was kind of an arm's length situation, you know, it was vulgar, but she and my dad, they knew it was good, and they're very conservative. We were friends with the Archbishop in Denver, and my parents were being interviewed by the Denver Post, and they said, well, your son's success as a queer, you know, icon, and then your friendship with Archbishop Chaput, you know, how do you reconcile all those different... And my mom's like, well, we love the Archbishop, but he never had a son.
Yeah. Were you ever Catholic?
Yeah, I was really religious. I think when my brother died, I just, that was the end of it. It was a real emotional
thing. There was a fourth kid?
There was a fourth kid. I remember praying that he would survive and he didn't. I was like,
all right, yeah.
This is not working for me.
And that one, it went away?
It went into the theater stuff. My stuff's pretty spiritual. You know, there's a lot of...
Trying to come together, trying to find a connection.
Theater's church for me, you know, definitely.
What happened to that kid?
He had a congenital heart thing that we didn't really know. And it just took them. The family just sort of exploded and never couldn't come together for each other. And it,
after that?
Yeah, everybody just went off towards religion or drugs or work or stories for me. We didn't know how to, it was the 70s, you weren't allowed to talk about it. There was no counselors. Priest would talk about it in a kind of, he's in heaven.
Right. But no practical sort of trauma therapy around.
Maybe everyone's over-talking now, but no one was talking at all then.
So it just destroyed the family?
It just shot us off in different directions, and there was a lot of depression and anger. Later, my dad said he thought he was going to leave the family.
Because he couldn't handle
it? In Albuquerque.
Yeah. Oh, really?
Because it was all falling apart. My mom was extremely depressed, and my brothers were off being delinquents, and I was being, you know, a good boy, but I was running off towards theater and science fiction and arts and stuff. And Marvel, you know, Marvel Comics.
And when did you start doing, getting involved with theater?
Well, I would have these crazes, you know, go from science fiction to fantasy to comics. And then it was theater, and I was like, oh, I want to know everything about it. It was Albuquerque Pat Heron was my drama teacher, and my first play was a Pinter play.
Which one?
At
the Homecoming?
Pius. No, The Birthday Party.
Oh, right.
So I didn't know it was weird. You know, it was just theater.
She was doing Pinter at St. Pius.
Yeah.
I grew up in Albuquerque.
Oh,
you went to high school
Kirtland.
With my brother. Yeah, Kirkland.
I went to St. Pius.
Yeah, my brother went to St. Pius.
Albuquerque is a weird town.
Yeah. Yeah, I grew up there. My little brother was a couple years behind you. He was a tennis guy. He was at Pius.
It was kind of a shitty school, but some cool people.
How many years did you live in Albuquerque?
Two. I came from Kansas, another army base. Junction City, Kansas, where Hedwig takes place. St. Pius was a huge metropolitan,
sure,
you know, explosive thing compared to Kansas.
Could walk across the street to either mall. That's a big deal. That was the first time I saw porn, was in the B. Dalton bookseller at Wen Rock when I was like 13 or 14, the history of underground comics. And I was just sitting there, in the humor aisle, you know, with a boner.
Yeah.
Because I'm looking at
tits.
Yeah. And I saw how things went in to each other. I saw that all in comics first.
I learned it from books too. The Joy of Gay Sex was in the Army bookstore.
Where?
In 1975. In Heidelberg, Germany, when we lived there, and I was like, I didn't question it, but the joy of, it was the 70s, right?
Right, sure.
Joy of Gay Sex, which also had drawings.
Right, the Joy of Sex drawings, the very detailed.
Then I realized I have
hippies.
Right, I was supposed to have a mustache to be gay. I didn't know.
So that was the obstacle? You're like, soon this will happen. So when you were in high school, where did the, how did rock and roll start to play into your life?
Before I came out, I was really more into soul music, and then I was into blues
and Tom Waits.
And
yeah, Tom Waits.
I just loved Muddy Waters.
But you love Muddy Waters?
I love Muddy Waters.
Wasn't he great?
I loved him. He was it. He was my favorite. You know, he was the basis of everything.
But he is the basis of everything.
Yeah.
If you like rock and roll.
Yeah.
Right?
And he could play one note and make it worth more than those 250 notes by Clapton, who I never was into, never into.
So you're like a blues guy.
Yeah.
It doesn't add up.
I know. but you know, I also loved what that became, which was, you know, Little Richard, who was the original rock and roll drag queen.
Sure.
Once I came out though, I was felt freed up. So I started getting into punk rock, and then I really discovered Bowie, but he scared me. The androgyny scared me because it was in me. It scared the shit out of me.
Why?
Well, I had a feminine side that I was scared of. And so it was all like, I got a pass, you know, like a Jew has got a pass as a goy after the war. I felt like that.
So that's how you handled it. You were able to.
Yeah.
That's where you learned how to act.
Later I became an actor.
Right.
I lived with a woman. Both of us were gay, and we never spoke, so we never knew each other were gay for the whole time. She's like, you like blues. I didn't know you were gay. You know, it was very important
to be
in the closet.
Right. So you're closeted and butch? Is that what you're telling
me?
Well,
no, I just had to be able to play it all. So that's
why. Were you dating women?
No, I mean, in college once, it was a mistake. Her dog bit me in the face. I took it as a sign. Never to date another woman. It was part Timberwolf.
What? What's that story?
I don't know. She was beautiful. I went out with her, so all the boys liked her.
Mm-hmm.
But I wasn't into her. I just used her as a
beard?
You know, a beard or a, you know, a piece of jewelry. I was felt terrible, and the dog knew.
Dog was on to you.
I still have a scar. Hi. These are my, Sugar Daddy gifts, which I sign and hand out because I'm anti-selfie, because I'm from the 70s. Hi, everybody. Hi, guys.
I don't want you to leave, John. You're too married. Thank you for marrying us.
7 years or something?
I married them.
We made it official.
It's real.
It's real.
Did everybody get one?
Did you ever look at Hedwig as something that you couldn't get out from under? Like, is it nothing?
No. I love the character, and I did it for a year, 7 shows a week. Almost killed me, and I quit acting because it was so fucking hard.
And you've been directing? What have you been doing?
I've been directing. I made 3 films, Hedwig and the Angry Inch.
Rabbit Hole?
Rabbit Hole.
You directed. You didn't write. And Short Bus, which you wrote and directed.
Yeah.
And which I watched recently.
Really?
I watched the whole thing. And at some point, I had to, like, because I have a house has, you know, two big open windows right on the street. And at one point, I'm like, I got to close the blinds.
I'm sorry, what?
I'm sorry, Mr. Severin. But I'm serious. What are your thoughts on procreation?
There's a lot going on in that film.
Yeah, there's three people.
Yeah.
Yeah.
We tried to break some barriers with that.
What were you trying to figure out with that movie?
So my parents never talked about sex. Sex was bad. I was gay. It was double bad. Mm-hmm. So what is that thing? I wanted to go there. You know, I was scared by it.
Wanted to break it wide open.
Yeah. And also I saw a kind of prudish thing in American cinema where sex was, either it was porn or it was, you know, French grim anomie films about mm-hmm. sex, or it was snicker, you know, British American films. Mm-hmm. And they would just skip over it. And I thought, if you're telling a story of first love, that first sex is very much part of the story. They're skipping over it to the morning. What happened?
Well, I think, like, yeah, the vibe, like, the weird thing about porn or about the nature of porn or about the nature of actual penetration cinematically is, like, it hits you in a much different space. That, like, you know, like, if you just have a narrative, like, you know, when in that movie, in your movie, when, for me, as a guy who doesn't watch gay porn,
right,
but I watch, you know, the other porn.
Right, and there's straight and gay sex in that film.
No, absolutely. But, like, you know, straight sex as well, you know, that's porn zone. That's, like, it hits a different part of my brain.
Yeah.
So if, you know, you're just going along, chipping along with a narrative, and then I'm all talking, oh, my God, it's going in.
Right.
So then I'm from a different place.
But if you had seen that more often in films as part of a story, it wouldn't go to just that part of the brain.
Maybe.
You know, it takes a few ones to start it.
Right.
You know, because porn is something else. That's
right.
For jerking off to, and it's a certain
product. I guess that's true.
Product.
Right.
Porn.
It's a means to an end. But then you find yourself just fast-forwarding to that part. The regular
or
movie.
Through it. You know, we did some improvs and they started having sex and it got boring because they no longer had a narrative. And bad sex in some ways is more interesting to watch in a narrative sense than good
like
sex.
Like failed sex?
Well, it's ridiculous.
Right.
I mean, what are we doing in these positions and, you know.
Right. Oh, like the scene with the three dudes.
Yeah.
Okay, rotate.
Yeah,
it's not working.
I thought that was very funny when he said, say something. Or,
oh, yeah, singing into his asshole.
Yeah, singing into his asshole,
There's a little statement there, too.
Was there?
I'm not sure what it was, but singing the national anthem into his asshole.
Oh, that's right. That's right. That's what it was. There's one cut in one of those scenes where you're making out with a guy.
Yeah, I'm actually eating pussy.
Really?
In one of those shots.
I like the way,
for my first and only time.
I like the way, when you say it with that, like, I was eating pussy.
My mother would have been delighted.
Oh, really? That would have done it?
No, it wouldn't.
Yeah, how was that for you?
You know, I thought that the clit was going to get really hard like a penis.
Yeah.
Because it seems like a vestige, you know, they say it's a vestigial or, you know, the penis is an overgrown clit.
Right.
But it was more like a water balloon, really. Isn't that what it's like?
Well, I think there are different ones. You know.
Are there some that are quite hard,
some
like a penis?
Yeah, some get harder, some are bigger than others, some are harder to find.
Maybe it was my problem.
What was your first time? You can't, you know, you might have to try a couple.
Do it again. It was delicious.
Was it?
Yeah.
Okay. You must have got a good one.
My mom, she and my dad, thank God they never saw it. You know, my mom was like, well, it's in town. We'll go see it if you want us to. And I'm like, don't go. She's like, it's snowing, but we'll go. Your father's very ill, but we'll go. I said, don't ever go see that. Because I don't
ever
want to talk
about it. Look, I appreciate you. You're proud of me.
Yeah.
You finally figured out how to be proud of me, but don't.
Eating pussy in it. Yeah. I know it's what you've always wanted me to do.
Like you said, she might be okay with that. It's the guy eating the other guy's asshole. With the national anthem.
Desecrated.
Yeah, all you needed is a guy holding a cross, and you could have, your mother, you would have killed your mother.
Stuffing the flagpole up his ass.
And when I think about all the
people I have come upon in my travels, I have to think about the people who have come upon me. Tommy, can you hear me? Yeah! From this milkless tit, you sucked the very business we call show.
So your boyfriend was alcoholic?
Yeah. Yeah, he was a wonderful guy who was in our band. He was a bass player. And we got together and I knew, and he had
in the original Hedvig band?
A bottle of whiskey at our first date. I was like, what am I doing? You know, I didn't know.
Yeah.
But I loved him.
How long were you together?
6 years. I don't know what I was. I was going to save him.
Yeah?
Yeah.
Did you learn about your own codependency?
Yeah, I did. I didn't realize I was so good at it. Because I didn't have it in my family.
No? No alcoholism?
No.
But you had some martyrs?
Yes. Oh, yes. And I became a director because of that. You know, actors are very needy, so.
And when did he die?
He died 2004, April 20th, the day before my birthday.
How old was he?
He was, I think, 35.
From alcoholism?
It was a combination of drugs, but that was the basis of it, you know, in Camden. He had a great family, never knew where all the pain came from. Maybe being gay and not being in a world that was okay, that didn't help. But he was a real punk rocker and taught me about what it was to be truly cool, you know, kindly and cool, and knew all about music. And he loved old men rockers. He used to hang out in old men bars, get drunk with old men.
The leather pants crowd? Rock and roll
like
guys?
Like Blarney Stoney.
Oh, okay. Not old men rockers.
That too.
Yeah.
But, you know, no one with attitude. Just people, you know, old guy. Yeah. He wanted to be an old guy.
Bukowskis.
Yeah. Yeah, laughing. You know, just making jokes. And he wanted to skip the middle part and go straight to
the old drunk part.
Great old guy. Yeah, I mean the drunk. Yeah, he liked it.
It's a romanticization.
He was
of that.
A sweet drunk.
Oh, that's good.
Well, the mean drunks have it easier because they got to deal with it sooner.
Yeah, it may be.
Maybe, unless they kill somebody. I don't know.
I don't know. You don't know what course that illness is going to take. It's horrible. There's no control over it. Well, now we're in dark parts. So it's like, like I watched Rabbit Hole.
Okay.
Now, it was your choice to direct that. You said, I'm going to direct
it. Yeah, because that was because of my brother. That was for my mom. That film was for my mom. And to understand a little bit about what she went through.
That was trying to reckon with the grief of losing a 4-year-old sibling.
Yeah, because I never understood it as a kid. You know,
what year did you make that?
2010.
You have to stop erasing him, you have to stop it!
Do you really think that I don't see him every second of every day? The video was an accident, Howie. And believe me, I will beat myself up about it forever, I'm sure. Just like everything else I could have prevented.
That's not what I want, Becca.
No, because it feels like it is. It feels like maybe I don't feel badly enough for you. Maybe I'm not feeling enough. What do you want from me?
It's so deep and sad.
Yeah.
That was for your mother.
Yeah, because she wasn't a super maternal person, you know, she grew up in the war in Scotland and had to, you know, get on with it, so she wasn't very touchy-feely. But when she lost the kid, I'm sure there was, the Catholic thing that comes there is you feel like you did it.
Yeah.
You know, that's the Catholic problem, is the guilt.
Right.
You know, what is it, Catholics do bad things, Jews, I'm a bad person?
Is that what, okay. I'm not sure what this thing is.
Because there's confession.
Yeah, that's right. You can just rid yourself of it. In the box. Go in the box.
Weekly.
Tell the guy. Yeah.
Pretty scientific.
Seems too easy. So were you able to process your grief through that film?
A little bit. I showed it to my family and there was kind of a cold response. Showed it just to them in the living room and my mom's reaction was like, well, that's not how we that's not how we reacted. Because it's a little bit, you know, non-religious in the film.
We just have to remind each other that it's just part of God's plan. And we can't know why. You know, only God can know why.
God had to take her. He needed another angel.
He needed another angel.
Why didn't he just make one? Another angel? I mean, he's God after all. Why didn't he just make another angel? Hmm?
She didn't like the kind of intimation of anti-religion in it, you know.
Oh.
So, but none of them really felt, seemed, you know, there was no tears. I was crying behind them, watching them watch it. But it didn't really bring us closer the way I hoped it would.
What's the story behind that mirror ball?
I think it's just a really old one they got from one of the, like, one of those, ballrooms like Roseland or something.
Oh my God, it looks like it's seen too much.
It's beautiful, right?
It's reflected too much.
Yeah.
There's something horrifying about it. That's all that's left of
Studio
Disco.
Studio 54.
Right, yeah. I hope that's the case. Now I want to know.
I know.
It looks like the only thing in here that's really old.
Yeah.
Everything else is like manufactured old.
Yeah.
Oh my God, the sad mirror ball.
Yeah. It is weird. I don't feel a whole lot in here. I'm just remembering people being in here, but it's
really you could probably smoke in here back then.
No.
No?
Not in a theater.
Oh.
Can't smoke in a theater.
It was sort of like a rock.
But we could drink. Yeah. We wanted to have a place the audience was drunk.
Sure. Yeah.
Right? I mean, that's the basis of stand-up comedy. I mean,
I don't like it when they're drunky.
You don't?
No, because then they start
crosses
to think.
The line.
Well, you know, there's too much intimacy sometimes, and they.
Everyone becomes the host of the show.
Right, and everybody's sort of like, yeah, exactly. You know, like, why are you talking to me?
How that's cell phones. That's YouTube too.
Yeah, well, no, but like because I'm conversational sometimes, especially if people are close, they'll eventually start to sort. Yeah, exactly. Oh, right. No, I'm like, no, we're not. It's not a bunch of us here.
So now you're like, the revival of Hedwig. I hear it was amazing. Did you have a good time doing it again?
After I had way more fun than I did here. Yeah, I came back to the show this winter, having not really performed on stage for 15 years, and certainly not this role. And
but doing some acting.
Really, only a few days on Girls.
That's all you did in 15 years.
Yeah.
Hedwig is performed around the world by different companies, so you get royalties from that.
Yeah, I mean very few, because it was never a big theater kind of a thing till now. Yeah, it would be like small productions. It's huge in Japan and Korea. It's been running there for 10 years. My
nonstop.
Dick is huge in Japan.
Yeah, my line. Yeah, yeah.
And Korea is actually the most popular of any country per capita.
So just ongoing. So it has a cult following. So people see it many times.
Yeah, and it's kind of more mainstreamy in Korea, weirdly.
Huh. But that's a nice paycheck, right? So you
it's not enough to it wasn't enough to live on, but it was, you know, it was nice.
And
but it was never a Rocky Horror or Wicked or something. It was just like, you know, Stephen Trask and I, the co-creators, we always thought things were, you know, conditions were changing. It was perhaps right to do it on Broadway and kind of bring Hedwig back in a mainstream way.
That was your idea?
We were both talking about it. Stephen Trask, the composer, and I.
And then you had to get someone to back it.
Well, David Binder, our original producer, he was really the guy who spurred it. And
he's been around a long time, that guy.
Yeah. Yeah, he did our first production at Westbeth, which was just across the street.
I did a show at Westbeth.
Yeah.
In 1999.
That was a great place, right?
Yeah.
It's very...
Arnold.
Socialist theater. Arnold Engelman.
Arnold Engelman.
Yeah.
So you guys decided, you guys got people to get behind the revival, and then all of a sudden won a lot of Tonys.
Yeah.
Right, that was exciting.
Yes.
Must have been exciting.
Very exciting.
And this year you're getting a special
Tony.
What's the special? It's a special John Cameron Mitchell Tony?
I think it's kind of one of, it feels a little bit like one of those I've been performing for 85 years, and...
And then all of a sudden Broadway was like, oh, look, these two.
These guys.
Oh, what a great show that was that we didn't really acknowledge back in the day.
What's an old drag queen doing up here uptown? Some people, like, you know, they make fan
sure,
art.
Sure, the paintings, yeah.
This is a double-sided Hedvig, and then...
Oh, yeah.
And then me.
Oh, wow.
It's pretty nice, right?
Yeah. That's and great.
It's a lot of...
Oh, look at that.
That was someone who actually did some art on the film, but isn't that amazing?
Yeah. All right, let's look at these. I want to see these. We shot some short interviews with your fans. Now let's see if Grandpa can do the thing.
When I first saw the movie, I was in a real dark place. Drugs, doing stupid stuff with my life. And my friend who's transgender, she showed me the movie. She's like, you know, I'm trying to get sober. I know that you're going through this. This movie has really kind of helped me watch it with me. And it took a while for it to click, the message. I watched it a lot, you know.
How many times?
I broke his VHS.
This will be my 14th show, 15th and 16th show tonight, yeah.
10th or 11th maybe? Maybe more than that actually, I don't know.
19, 20, 20.
11.
Be 15.
Over 200 times.
88 times.
Hedwig wa daisuki! Mo hoka ni nai deshou, konna subarashii show.
I've been through the transgender struggle for years. The world is getting so much better for us. The world is getting so much more accepting all the time, and it's wonderful. It's just like, I just want to live my life, and thank you all for not beating me up and killing me sometimes, is what I feel.
Inspiration, motivation, it's everything that has meaning for me now.
I really wanted a shroud. Like, every single time I've been...
That's the shroud of hope.
And when he threw it right at me, I squealed and I fucking burst in tears. I couldn't even be happier that I, like, it's just, this is the most wonderful thing.
Sweet.
I recognize a lot of those faces.
You do?
Yeah.
How does it make you feel?
You know, it kind of choked me up when I was watching that. You know, you have to pause and remind yourself that you're, you know, on the right track and that good things happen from what you did.
Yeah.
When it's happening and I'm meeting these people, sometimes it's hard to...
Sure.
To feel that because there's so much coming at you.
Right.
So I have all these fan letters from the show that I would like to read when the Alzheimer's kicks in.
Sure.
Do you know what I mean?
Yeah. And also the character of Hedvig is so, it's a deep character who's struggling with the self-acceptance, with desiring love, wanting to be recognized for who they are, both on a talent level and also an emotional level. You know, feeling different, all the stuff that awkward people feel, you know, for whatever reason, is sort of liberated in that show.
Yeah.
And that's, that is freeing. That's spiritual, I would imagine, to some of those people.
It freed me up as a person to do it. Nothing scared me about performing after that. Also, I'm not really an actor as much anymore.
You're good. You're directing and you're doing other things.
Yeah, I'm sure I'll end up writing novels on a cliff somewhere.
That's the arc?
I would
Small cabin writing
that.
Novels on a cliff.
Totally.
And then every once in a while, fans will come knock on your door and go, hi! Hi, John.
Sign my left tit. I did sign someone's penis with my entire name once.
That's impressive.
It was flaccid.
Yeah. Really? How was that for you?
It was great.
It's good talking to you, man.
You too.
I don't know, we good up there?
Good.
That was good.
I feel like we're just talking about everything and no one's gonna know what we're talking about.
It'll come together.
All right.
Nice to meet you.
Pleasure.
Thanks for doing it, man.
You're welcome.